welcome to the house of Epic. We worship the one true King. We worship God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Father God, we worship you, the risen King, this morning.
One, two, three.
Risen, he's risen, forever glorified. Risen, he's risen, King Jesus.
Same power.
that you're risen. You're still seated on the throne, Father God. Nothing's changed. The same power in you is in us, Lord God. We declare this morning that we will give praises to the King of Kings, Lord. Join the sound of heaven, Lord. Come and join in the song that the angels sing. Glory to our God in heaven's King.
Your mighty name, Lord, we cry like a banner.
The glory, I will sing your praises.
Standing in your presence, Shekinah glory.
Shekinah glory come. Shekinah glory come. Release the fullness of your spirit. Shekinah glory come. Shekinah glory come.
Come, 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 come. Revelation 3:21. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and I will dine with him and he with me. And I just, you know, we're not just standing in his presence this morning looking around, but when his fullness comes, I'm praying in his presence, I'm joyful in his presence, I'm weeping in his presence, I'm broken in his presence. But this verse is very clear that when we hear his voice, he's standing at the door, and if we'll come and open the door, it doesn't just say he comes in, but he comes in and he dines with us. It's not a breakfast. It's not a snack. That there is a meal. There is a fullness. There is meat. And so as we just continue just to worship for a minute, I'm here. I just need you to get out of the thought that you're just in a big room looking around. But that when he comes in, there is a meal for you. That whatever, there's a filling and a fullness. But we've heard his voice this morning that he is calling us. And we've released a declaration saying, we want the fullness of you. And God, this morning, our expectation is that in this room, as we come together in unity, that we come to the door where you are knocking. And we open that door. And you will come in and eat with us. And you with us and us with you, it's mutual. This morning, Father, we thank you that every wall of separation has been removed because Jesus has come in to our life. This morning, Jesus, we thank you for the food of your word, for the breakthrough that comes by your spirit. From glory to glory, Father, from face-to-face encounter to face-to-face encounter. Shekinah glory come individually this morning in every seat, in every mind, in every heart. Shekinah glory come. So just this morning, open the door. Say, God, I open the door. I come to the door and I let you in. Again, as a believer, it's again and again and again. To every wounded place, to every place that's hurting, to every place that's been rejected, to every place of disappointment. We move through our disappointment this morning by the Spirit of God, and we move on to our appointment with God. He is enough this morning, more than enough.
Cause you move and we want more, more of your. Cause you move and we want more. Cause you speak and we want more. Cause you move and we want more. More of your fullness. Cause you move and we want more. Cause you speak and we want more. Cause you move and we want more. More of your fullness.
Cause you move in us, Lord.
We want more.
As you speak,
we want more.
Lord. As you move,
we want more. More of your fullness.
So Lord,
as you move, we want more. As you speak, we want more. As you move, we want more. More of your fullness.
Release it, Lord. Release the fullness.
Speak, we want more.
We want more.
As you move, we want more. More of your fullness.
Release it all. Oh, release it all. Oh, release it all. Pour it out in us, Lord. Pour it out in us, Lord. Oh, pour it out. The Lord has given us freedom, given us freedom, given us joy.
And full of his spirit this morning. We receive it this morning. Just lift your hands to him this morning. His fullness is ours. His joy is ours. And he stands at the door and knocks. And this morning we have heard his voice and we have gone and opened it. And as we continue to move on this morning in the service, we're going to eat with him. Continue to eat. And so, Father, this morning, we lift our hands to you and surrender, Father. We thank you that whatever we came in with, that this morning has been confronted by the Spirit of God and is about to be confronted by the Word of God. And we can't help but get healthy, get whole, and get aligned. In Jesus' name we pray this morning. Amen. Amen. Can you just greet somebody around you? Welcome them. We come into agreement this morning for everything that God has for you. If you're visiting us this morning, we welcome you to Epic Church. On behalf of our founding pastors, Apostle Shirley and Pastor Steve Arnold, and our executive pastors, Pastor Michael Melody Cosby, we want to welcome you. I'm Pastor Stephanie Renovales, and I'm our Connections pastor, and we're just going to take a look at the screens and see what's going on here at Epic.
Good morning, Epicans and guests. Thank you for joining us today. Listen, go ahead and get out your phones or tablets and check in with us at Epic Church Lakeland on Facebook. Don't forget to like our page, Calling All Warriors. come on out and join us for prayer every Tuesday night starting at 6:30 p.m. The Bible says that men ought always to pray and not faint. See you there. Baby dedications are scheduled for May 8th. If you're interested, please visit the Information Center in the lobby.
Mark your calendars for Growth Track 3.0 next week at 9 a.m. Come and learn more about your personality, spiritual gifts, and how to use our design for His kingdom.
Ladies, if all you do is work, 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 well, mark your calendar for April the 23rd because this will be a day for you to shine bright like a diamond. We are going to have a day of fun and fellowship, so come dressed in your favorite dress because we are going to have tea at Tiffany's and an evening of ministry. For more information, please visit the Information Center in the lobby.
Behold how good and pleasant it is for men to dwell together in unity. Guys, get ready to relax and have some fun at Epic Men's Fishing Trip. It's scheduled for May 21st. The cost is only $50 per person due by May 1st. For more information, contact Nick Brokers at the Information Center in the lobby.
For more information, check out your weekly newsletter or visit the Information Center in the lobby.
All right. Good morning, Epic Church. I was laughing as Pastor Stephanie just asked if people were awake. I saw somebody waving like this. But we hope that you're having a great morning. God is good. He really is good. I've just been just basking in a sweet place in Him, just reminded of His goodness, that regardless of what has been going on, every opportunity that we get to come into the presence as the community of believers to worship Him together, that there's nothing like it. And so I'm just filled with joy this morning, but I get the wonderful opportunity to receive our tithes and offerings this morning. And been reading in John 15, and it's the parable of the sower. And I don't know how many of you have green thumbs, but that was Home Depot had a sale yesterday, and so I was out there, yes sir, getting, you know, mulch and been cleaning out beds. And me and my kids were outside yesterday, and we're starting to kind of get the garden prepared. And this word just really began to take a greater shape and revelation because I begin to think about the soil. And I begin to just understand this idea that sometimes we feel like it's done because we don't see anything. And God just began to reveal to me, Ray, all you have to do is give the soil what it needs. Because there's life already in it. All you have to do is give it what it needs. It needs a little turning over. It needs some weeds pulled out. It needs some watering. And instantly, life is given back to the soil. And as we give today, the question I have for you is this. What's your soil look like? Because some of us, man, we have fruit and we're bearing fruit and the soil is good. But there are others where, man, you can't see a thing. And you're like, man, I've tried, God. I've tried and I've tried and I've tried. And His word for you this morning as we give, man, there's life in the soil. There's life in the soil. So we give to God what's His. The tithe is His. There's no question. There's not a debate. We don't get to dialogue about it. Again, some things you just got to settle. This is one of those things like I've just settled. God, I can't do it without You. So I come into the house this morning recognizing that I give to You what's Yours. So if you'll prepare your tithes this morning, we get the opportunity to give the natural to the supernatural and watch what He does in your life. Watch what He fulfills. Watch the life that's given back to the soil in your ground. Just because we say yes and we align ourselves with the Father. So if you would stand this morning. bring your tithe.
You move, we want more. Cause you speak, we want more. Cause you move, we want more. More of your fullness. Cause you move, we want more. Cause you speak, we want more. Cause you move, we want more. More of your fullness. Cause you move, we want more. As you speak, we want more. As you move, we want more. More of your fullness. As you move.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Hey, this is where it starts. This is where it starts. I'm so grateful that we are teaching this generation what it means to give, what it means to bring to God what's His. Hallelujah. The next opportunity for us to give our offering, this is something the Holy Spirit just dropped in my spirit, and I need you to catch it. So the offering is the time in which we get to, man, this is now what we're saying. Hey, God, man, because you have done, established, provided in my life, I've given you what's yours. Now I get to give just because I want to give to you. And the word the Holy Spirit dropped in me this morning was this: where's your prison song? See, it's easy for us to rejoice in the moments of joy, but what the disciples caught when they were in prison was their prison song brought about a manifestation of the presence of God. So where is your prison song? Because some of us, man, we can give the God what's God's, but if I gotta give you any more, I don't know if I will have enough. Where's your song in that moment? Because in that moment, He is waiting to step in and manifest what only He can do. In that story, it says, man, the gates, the chains fell off, the gates were open, and the freedom of the presence of God manifested itself in that prison. And there could be nothing but freedom left. So this morning, as you bring your offering, man, remind yourself that it's easy to praise Him and to rejoice when I can see His provision. But when I'm bound and it's hard to see and I can't make it out, can I find my prison song? Because that joy and that expression to the Father is going to release what you've been waiting on. It's going to free what you couldn't see. So this morning, I hope that you can hear what's being expressed, that there is a song that comes in that moment that can reach out from the natural and tap into a supernatural God. So as you bring forth your offering, where's your prison song this morning? Please bring your offering. Father, we thank you, we praise you, we bless you, Almighty God. You are our provider. You are creator of all things, heaven and earth. Father, and at the end, every knee shall bow. And so we bring to your storehouse, Father, not only our tithes, but our offerings, knowing that you are going to bless this house. You are going to bless every servant, every soul in this community and in this body that has aligned itself with you. And so we ask, God, that you would do supernaturally what we can't do in the natural. We praise you and we worship you in your name. Amen.
Hallelujah. 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 That's about the biggest, best word we have to praise to the God Most High. Hallelujah. 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 So praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, praise the Lord. Make that declaration in the atmosphere today. Praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, praise the Lord. So praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Sometimes we just need to tell our soul to praise the Lord. Sometimes we just need to make that declaration in the atmosphere, whatever it is that we're facing, whenever it is that we face it. Sometimes we just need to remember and tell our soul to praise the Lord and declare it over our, and you'll be amazed at what will take place in your life. When you begin to just declare it and let your mind catch up with your spirit and let your flesh catch up with your spirit and let your soul begin to just shout the praises of the Most High God, and you just begin to say, praise the Lord, O my soul. 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 And you just begin to just say it over and over and repeat it. It begins to silence the voice of the enemy, the voice that was saying you're no good, you can't do it, you can't make it, you'll never be what you're supposed to be, you're not supposed to be doing what you're doing right now. That makes no sense what you're doing right now. Don't even keep going. That's why you're tired every day. That's why you're depressed every day. That's why you can't make it another step. But you just keep repeating to yourself in your ears where you can hear it. And it'll begin to silence that voice of the enemy. Just say, praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. And as you do it, you can begin to sense the fire of the Holy Spirit beginning to rise up inside of you and beginning to increase and overtake every function and ability of your body and begin to move you into a place to where you can see yourself as God sees you. And all of a sudden, everything that was impossible and can't be done, and what was hard and what was keeping you down and out begins to just fade away because you can see that all things are possible, and encouragement begins to rise up on the inside. And it doesn't matter how long it's taken you to get to where you are right now, and it doesn't matter how long it's taken you to finally move into the place where you are, and it just seems like you keep circling the mountain and circling the mountain, and none of that begins to matter anymore because you get a revelation of who you are and the power that you have and the authority that sets upon you, all because you sat in a minute in a corner somewhere and said, praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. And the unction of the Holy Spirit begins to rise up and overtake you, and you can take over everything that God has called you to. So praise the Lord, oh my soul. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Hallelujah. 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 I want to talk to you today about the holy altar. starting at Exodus chapter 29, I'll read verse 36, and then we'll talk about that a little bit and come back to verse 37 a little later. So Exodus chapter 29, starting in verse 36, it says, "Each day you must sacrifice a young bull as a sin offering to purify them, them being Aaron and his sons being set in as high priests for the very first time, making them right with the Lord. Afterwards, cleanse the altar by purifying it and make it holy by anointing it with oil." So I want to talk about the Old Testament process of holiness here. The Old Testament process required days to take place, 7 days to be exact. They would sacrifice and do all of these ceremonies for 7 days. 7 days being the number of completion, the number of perfection, understanding that. So that was the process that it had to go through for 7 days to set Aaron and his sons in as the high priest and getting everything established so that they could have a way to God and access to him in some tangible way, because he was so holy and so awesome and so perfect that we could not see him or have access to him without dying. So even Moses couldn't see anything but the back of him just as he was going away. If he didn't turn himself away into the mountain, then Moses would have surely died at that point. Moses was in the presence of God so much so that they had to put a veil over his face because it shone so bright that the people couldn't even look on him. It was brighter than the sun. It's like, I don't know how to talk to you because your face is so bright. So there had to be a process by which man could now communicate with God from the fall. So here's this process of creating the temple, a way for them to worship and have access and get forgiveness and all of that through this process. So that 7-day process was that getting them holy and sanctified. That word holiness there is kadosh, which means to cut or to separate. And it also means morally or physically. So there's a process there by which they were being all the bad thing, all the transgressions and sins and all the things of the earth was being cut off of them, but at the same time they were being separated and set apart from the rest of everybody else by going through the 7-day process. So in the Old Testament, it was a physical act. They did something, you saw it happen, and holiness took place as a result of that. So it was 7 days, it was a physical act, and it required sacrifices, plural. So every day they had to offer a sacrifice. After then they were set in and were holy, the process of making the altar holy and taking that and had to go through everything and getting it. So it was all about a physical outward act. So it was so easy. You get up there, if the bull got burned up, then you were good. I mean, it's just that easy, all right? So everybody saw it too, you know? So it's like, yeah, your sacrifice didn't get burnt today. You didn't come with the right attitude or something, you know? So you need to square that away and go get you another one and work that out and follow. So it was real easy to determine and figure out. It was a physical act. Now, sometimes we like to do that. It's so easy for us to do the outward things when the inward stuff's all messed up. So on the outside, we look good. We have all these great acts of kindness, and we give, and we look great doing it, you know. We're down in the trenches. We roll up our sleeves and we give of ourselves and we do whatever's required. We have a great attitude. We have great obedience, and we see that and we stand witness to that, but yet we're living the New Testament, not the Old Testament. The New Testament speaks of an inward part of us. So we began to have to transition ourselves from, yeah, in the Old Testament, it was all about a physical act, and that physical act wouldn't work right if you didn't have the inward stuff done. But today we see that a lot, that we see the physical acts of things, but sometimes on the inward side, we're not really walking in the holiness of what we should be doing and walking in the place where we should be walking. And so it looks like we're okay, and we make sure we keep up our appearances, but inside, something much worse is going on here. So we find ourselves transitioning here in the New Testament, where Jesus is the once and all sacrifice. And it says here in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, starting in verse 16. Do you not know that you are the temple of God and the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him, for the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. So here in the New Testament holiness, it's a process of salvation. There was a one-time sacrifice that covered everything that ever was, everything that was at that moment, and everything that will ever be in the future. We just have to accept that to our lives. So we now are the ones who have to accept the sacrifice, not God, where God was accepting the sacrifice that we offered. Now we have to accept the sacrifice that God offered for us. So now it's transitioned in the New Testament where it's all on us. We have to make the decision that we're going to accept the sacrifice that once and for all. Now, it's always there. God did what he was going to do, and that's going to be done, period. There's nothing we can do to change, but we can in our free will, because God wants us to love him, and because he wants us to love him, he gives us free will. You cannot have love without free will. Other than that, it's appreciation, or maybe gratitude, or, you know, something like that, that you feel kindness or something like that. But if you are told what to do and you have to do and you have no free will of choosing what it is, you will never, ever love. And because God wants us to choose him, he gave us, and love him, he gave us free will to do that. So he made the sacrifice that was the purest and best of all sacrifices that will ever be and could ever be. And so we don't have to offer up sacrifices anymore and lift them up every day, because that's already been done. So we must accept that. So in the New Testament, the holiness portion begins with salvation. We must bow down on the knee and confess that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior and allow him to take reign in the temple that is inside of you. Okay, so you are the temple of the Holy Spirit, and without accepting Jesus Christ as a person, he is not sitting on the throne of your heart. Somebody else is. Somebody else is ruling the temple of God inside your life if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. So what happens is that salvation process, we get convicted of the Holy Spirit, we say yes, we come down to an altar, we say a prayer on the street somewhere, or in an office building, or in a restaurant, or wherever it may be, and we've accepted Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, and now he evicts the enemy out, cleans up everything, and takes seat on the throne, and sits there and reigns and rules in the temple of your body. And now you have begun the process of being holy. Holiness is that process by which we become one with God. It's the only thing that separated us and them. It's the only thing that made God's people God's people. Because he was holy, it's a way to also become holy, offer up those sacrifices, or become a living sacrifice. And so we offer ourselves. There's no coincidence that it says that it's the sacrifice of praise. It's not easy in the midst of your trouble to start praising. It's not easy in the midst of your schedule and your busyness and all the things that you've got to add praise into it. It's hard. We've got things to do. We don't want to be looked at like a crazy person. We have those people in our places of business that are those people. You know, you have these labels that we put on people. You know, we have the talker. You know, so if we ever need to know anything about what's going on, we go to the talker. We just kind of hang around, just see if we can pick up a little bit of information, fix coffee beside them, because we know that sooner or later they're going to spill the beans about everything, because the rumor mill. I mean, they are the newsletter of the place. They are it, you know. So we got all these labels going, and we don't want to be categorized in that label as, you, well, that's that holy one there, or that holy roller person kind of thing. You know, you just don't want to get around them too much because they're just going to say Jesus this and Jesus that and Jesus blah, 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 and everything about Jesus all the time. Jesus and the Bible said, Bible said, Bible said. Everything's Bible said. They somehow make a paper into a Bible lesson. I just asked if I could borrow a pen, and they said somehow turn that into a Jesus lesson. And all I want to do is borrow a pen. So we don't want to necessarily do that because it's stepping outside of that. That's why it's a sacrifice for us to kick our flesh aside and say, no, I'm not going to listen to you anymore. I don't care what you have to say, and move into a place that I'm going to praise the Lord. I'm going to worship the Lord. I'm going to get in right with God. So we have this contrast and comparison here between the New Testament and Old Testament, but the result is still the same, and that is holiness. There's a process by which we all had to go through and submit to so that we could all become holy, so that we could be one with God, because He wants us to be holy as He is holy. So let's kind of walk through that process here of the holiness. So 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15 and 16, it says, "But as He who called you is holy, you also be holy in your conduct, because it is written, 'Be holy, for I am holy.'" Now it says, "For it is written." Now if we go to Leviticus, we find it almost everywhere at the end of every chapter, because in Leviticus, it goes through those very specific, detailed rules and laws that we must abide by. And at the end of it, it says, "Be holy, for I am holy." So He would say, "Don't eat this, don't eat this, don't eat this, don't eat this, don't eat this, blah, blah, blah," go through the whole thing. And then at the end, "Because if you eat holy, and I want you to be holy." So in order for you to be holy, let's stay away from these things. Let's refrain from these things, because there was a process of holiness that God wanted them to be a part of so that they could be in oneness with Him, so that His people would reflect who He is. God wants us to reflect who He is. So He says here in Leviticus 11:45, "For I am the Lord who brings you up out of the land of Egypt to be your God. You shall therefore be holy, for I am holy." It is necessary for us to realize that God wants us to be holy at all times, every day, in every way. All the time. It is that oneness with Him. It is what sets us apart. He wants people to look at you and see something different. He wants some kind of identifying marker that says, "These are my chosen people," and that you also have an opportunity to participate in what they participate in if you will also go through this process of accepting Me as your personal Savior and letting Me be the once and for all sacrifice. So there is this holiness process that separates us. But with that I don't even want to list, because I'm afraid that that's what we look for in all the things that we do. And holiness will bring healing. Holiness will bring prosperity. Holiness will bring blessing. Holiness will have grace in your life and favor and anointing. And the list goes on and on of all the yes and amen things that are going on in your life, just because you've allowed holiness to have its perfect work in you, so that you can be one with God, look like God, behave like God, conduct yourself as God would on this earth, and be His vessel used by Him to bring Him glory in every way. God is calling us every day, all the time, to holiness. He's calling Him to Himself all the time. If we continually bring things to Him and offer things up to Him, we will continue to keep that close relationship with Him. I find myself sometimes, when I have a very busy week, finding I begin to just separate from God. It's like I'm not hearing You like I'm used to hearing You. I don't know what's going on. Why can't I hear You? What, You're normally talking to me more than this, and normally I'm getting a little more guidance during the week and during the day, and I just can't figure out what it is that's just not right, and what, something's not there. And all of a sudden I realize that I haven't done this week what I normally do in most weeks, where I'm reading my Bible every day, where I'm praying and asking for forgiveness and trying to restore that right relationship with God at all times, because I know that I don't go a day without thinking something that I shouldn't think, if not taking it a step further and actually acting on that. I know that. I mess up every single day because I encounter people every single day. And so because of me encountering people, I have to bridle my tongue and I have to bridle myself back and hold myself from doing stuff because I truly love people. I have a passion for them. But there are moments when it's just like, did you really create this one? I mean, really? I mean, is this really one of your creations? Are you messing with me here? Is this like a mirage or something here? Because there's no way a human could really behave this way or even think like this here. So, you know, I'm in that process of trying to say, oh, God, help me deal with these people, you know? I want to stay holy. And so I know that at the end of that day, if I haven't cleared that back up and brought that up to the Lord and said, okay, God, I realize that that's your creation, and I apologize, and please forgive me for anything that I said about that person or thought about that person or how my behavior changed in dealing with that person, so that please forgive me of that, and restoring that right relationship and beginning to pray with God and talk to him and read his word so that I can know more about him, so that I can learn more about God and have a better understanding of his personality and how he loves and what he thinks and what he's wanting to do and how I can be a part of that and having that constant communication with him. And so with them, it was more ritualistic that they would do this on a weekly basis or a monthly basis, and then the one day of atonement one time per year. So it wasn't like every single day they came up and did all this stuff. It was just this ritualistic process. But we have access because we are the temple, and we can have access to the Holy Spirit at any time, and we can go to him and say, Father, I just desire to be holy today. I know that I can't even enter your throne today because I'm just unclean, and he can just take a little bit of a coal and touch it to our lips so he can purify us, so that we can function that day and be holy as he is holy, because he's calling us to a process of holiness in our lives so that we can be a fully functioning temple of the Most High God, where he can dwell inside of us and function through us in the way that he has called us to. So we read the first part of Corinthians there in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, and starting in verse 9. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. According to the grace of God, which was given to me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation and another builds on it. But let each one take heed how he builds on it. For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Christ Jesus. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, and precious stones, wood, hay, and straw, each one's work will become clear. For the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work, which he has built on it, endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through the fire. And then it goes on to say, do you not know that you are the Holy Spirit? Now let's go back to Exodus chapter 29 and verse 37. After we've purified man and purified, making it holy, anointing with oil on the altar, it says, purify the altar and consecrate it every day for 7 days. After that, the altar will be absolutely holy, and whatever touches it will become holy. We have to start bringing things to the altar. We have to get the things in our life to the altar as fast and as hard as we possibly can, because it needs to be tested by fire before we start using it on the building, on the foundation that is laid in our heart. And so what happens inside of me is there's things that are going on that I just want to hold on to so tight. And I'm not sure whether they're of God or not. And I'm not ready to find out. But there's a desire inside of me that wants to be holy, just because he's holy. And I want to be like him more than I want to be like anything else. There are people on this earth that I used to learn my lifestyle after. I would learn to speak like. I would learn to teach like and walk like. I would try to hold my hands the way they would hold their hands and move like they move until I encountered God. And there's nothing on this earth that I want more than to be like Him. And the only way that I can be like Him is through holiness. And the only way I can go through holiness is I have to start bringing things to the altar. And we've got to get it. And it's not about taking my sin, Lord, make my sin holy. It's about finding out if it's consumable or not. If it burns up in the fire, you got to get rid of it. Sin's going to burn up in the fire. Disobedience is going to burn up in the fire. Lying is going to burn up in the fire. Cheating is going to burn up in the fire. Stealing is going to burn up in the fire. Blasphemy is going to burn up in the fire. Insubordination is going to burn up in the fire. Dishonoring and disrespect is going to burn up in the fire. Mistreatment of others. It's going to burn up in the fire. Prejudice and racism and all the other list of things, bigotry and all of that stuff, it's going to burn up in the fire. Because God wants us to be holy because He is holy. It's going to get burned up in the fire. And so I can find myself in that place where I haven't been talking with God on an everyday basis. And I feel like I'm just weighted down. Like I can't move or go any further or make it any farther or do anything. And I just feel this weight that's on me all the time. Where it's just like, I'm just, have you ever wore clothes that just don't fit right, or they're too tight, and the whole day they just don't feel like your clothes. It's just like, God, I just can't get this thing right to hang on me right. It just feels weird all day long. That's what it's like. It's like you're having this, if something is on me that's not right and that shouldn't be here and doesn't belong here, and it's just weighing us down and keeping us from all the things that God has called us to, and it's keeping us from being holy as He is holy. And what happens is it begins to slow us down and weight us down, and we just start moving slower and we can't accomplish all the things that God has called us to accomplish. We've moved into a place where we feel like the power of God has been released in our life, and we can do all these great and wonderful things, but all of a sudden, after that period runs out, and we got the newness of it wears down, we just feel this weight and this uncomfortable. It's because we're starting to build things without going to the altar first to make sure that it's going to be good material to make it through there, because the concrete is mixing for the walls to be built on that foundation, and I'm trying to bring sand or chunks of wood or things like that that's going to weaken it and go through that. And so I'm building this foundation that's not going to stand up and hold up to anything because of the impurities I'm putting into the ingredients to make the wall. And I didn't go through the altar first to find out if I can burn it and if it's consumable, because if it is, then I can't put it in the mix. And so I find myself weighted down. I'm like, oh, man, I just can't. I just don't understand why. It's just so hard to keep going. And I was so excited in the beginning, and I can't do it. And it's just because we haven't brought things to the altar. And in whatever way and whatever method we can, we've got to grab that thing and get a full grip on it and drag it to the altar. If we have to do it one step at a time, if we have to pull it with all of our might, whatever it is that we have to do, we have to get it and drag it, because it doesn't want to let go. It wants to hold on to the very core of our being. It wants to keep us from being who God called us to be. It wants to keep us from receiving that blessing. It wants to keep us from that oneness of God. It wants to keep us from building on top of the foundation and increasing the building so that it can hold more and do more and be blessed more. And so it wants to keep us. So it's going to lay there lifeless and try to grab a hold of the walls and all of that stuff. It's kind of like at a pool party, the one person who doesn't want to go swimming with everybody, you're going to throw that person in. You just are. I mean, it's just like, yeah, you're going in today. So I appreciate the fact that you didn't bring your bathing suit. And, you know, I appreciate that you're not going to do that. And so you can give up your cell phone now, or you can go in with it. So You have a choice. You can do that. But in that, during that process, it still doesn't keep them from fighting, from being thrown into the pool. They're like grabbing everything. They're trying, and then they're digging their heels in. They're like, no, I'm not going to do this. And their fingers are sliding along the walls and on the ground. They're grabbing chairs and everything else. And that's what happens in our life, is that we've got things in there that don't want to be, that won't want to be touched. Don't mess with this dark closet. You haven't messed with it in years. There's no reason to touch it or get it out, because it's just there. It's okay. But I'm telling you, your baggage is costing you more today than it ever has. I tell you what, and if you want to know the truth, go onto a plane and see if it doesn't cost you more to carry bags. I'm telling you what, that baggage is costing you more than it ever has in your entire life. It's weighing you down and keeping you from a oneness from God. He wants you to be holy for holiness' sake. He doesn't want you to be holy because you get healing, although you will. He doesn't want you to be holy because of blessing, because you will. He wants you to be holy because He is holy. And when you become holy in the process, and you become like God, and you're beginning to function in oneness with Him, there is a communion of the like no other in the history of the world. But we've got to go to those places, and we've got to drag it to the altar. We've got to get both feet out and pull it on out and get it to the altar and find out if it's something we've got to get rid of in our life, or is it something that's going to be of use. If you're not using it for the building, then you need to take it for the altar and find out if it's consumable or not. We've got to get it out. Everything keeping us from what God has for us, everything keeping us from holiness in our life, has got to be gone and dragged to that altar. We've got to begin to bring it there, and you will find a renewed strength inside of you, that the weights are coming off of your hands and feet. You will find a newness of life like you've never known before. You will find a oneness with God that you've never had before. And then the desire of your heart will begin to shift and say, I don't want anything but this ever. This is the greatest thing I've ever experienced in my entire life. How can I have more of this? How can I be more like God? What way can I do? Is there any other dark corners and dark closets in my life that I can bring to the altar and lay up on the altar and find out if it's consumable or not? We've got to be holy for holiness' sake. That's the only thing that separates us. I'm reading through the Bible. They did what God says. They submitted to Him. But it was because of the holiness that made them different. They went through a process of dedicating themselves to God in every way. That's why it had to be this fine adornment of materials. This fine adornment of the finest metals and materials of the day is what made up the temple. And we have access now at all times because of the once and for all sacrifice. We used to have to let somebody go for us. And they went through the purification process, and they went into the veil to the most holy place. And only one person ever had access to that until that person died, and then another one replaced them. But for the whole people, only one person had the privilege one day out of the entire year to go beyond that veil and perform that one ceremony. Because holiness now is available to us all the time, and because we can bring things to the altar and begin to build on the foundation, which is Christ in our lives, and because we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, that veil has been torn, and we have access to the most holy place all the time. But we've got to go through the process of holiness, or it will destroy us, as it would have with Moses or anybody else. We've got to go through that process of beginning to drag it. Whatever you have to do, how much energy you have to expend, whatever it takes, get it out. Drag it out of those dark corners. Get it in that place. you will just be amazed at what will begin to open up and release in your life as a result of you beginning to go through the process of holiness. God will begin to pour out. He'll see that in you and that holiness, and there will be just something that releases in your body that says, oh God, you are the greatest in all the earth. There is no one that is like you. No one has ever been like you. No one will ever be like you. There is a worship that sets inside of you that wants to worship and bring honor and glory to the Most High God, because you realize that through the process of holiness and getting rid of the stuff, that the blinders begin to come off of your eyes and you begin to see truth as it was really spoke into this atmosphere. And God really spoke it to us and breathed it through His holy word and into our hearts, and you begin to see the whole truth revealed before your eyes, and you begin to realize the great and powerful, mighty and awesome God, and you begin to understand why it is that you need to fear Him, all because you've taken the steps and exercised the ability inside of you to begin to drag the enemy out of the corners of our hearts and minds and corners, dark places that we've got going on that maybe we didn't even know about. But when we start shining the spotlight and send that probe down inside of us, we begin to realize that there were some things right there that's keeping us from moving into the places God has called us to. And if we'll just get enough strength to pull it out and get it over to the altar to see if it's going to stand the trial of fire and lay it over there and watch it get consumed before our very eyes, so that we may be set free of it, so it's no longer keeping us from the anointing and the power and the blessing and all the stuff that goes along with it. If we can just find a way inside of ourselves to begin to go through with the Holy Spirit's guidance and bring us to a place of holiness, you will know truth like you've never known it before. You will know power like you've never known it before. You will know authority like you've never known it before. You will know love like you've never known it before. I can tell you, it will release something inside of you that will change you from the inside out. If we can just search it through and make the decision that we want to be holy for holiness' sake, because He's holy, I want to be holy. God, I want to be holy because You're holy. I'm tired of being weary in well-doing. I'm tired of finding it hard. I'm tired of my testimony not being released, or I'm being afraid to share You with others. Afraid of people seeing me for a Jesus freak. Afraid of being rejected because I say Jesus. Or cast out, or set aside, or set apart. Father, I'm tired of these things keeping me from holiness. I'm tired of these things keeping me from oneness with You. I'm tired of inserting my will above Your will in my life. Father, I drag them kicking and screaming to the altar right now. I'm kicking and screaming. I don't want to do it. I don't want to give it up. I'm comfortable where I'm at. I know what I know, and I'm comfortable with what I know and the way I live, and I've got everything worked out, and I've got my routine worked out, but I just realized something that is just so powerful, Lord, that it can just be greater. And Lord, I want the greater. I want the greater. I want the better. I want the fuller. Holiness is what sets us apart. Holiness. Father, I pray right now that a desire set inside of each and every one of us for holiness that sets us apart and calls us to who You are, God. Right now, Father, right now, let the seriousness of your presence begin to rise up inside of us. Begin to shine that light in the dark places of our hearts and minds and where we've hidden things, Father. We've even maybe even forgotten about them. Father, there's no reason for us to keep them. They are keeping us down and holding us back. Let us find the altar again. Let us light it up again. Let it be a place because anything that touches it will be made holy or it'll be consumed. One way or the other, Father, it begins to get turned over to you. And right now, begin to search inside of us. Begin to probe inside of us for the things that we need to begin to drag back to the altar so that they can be made holy again. Tools and talents and gifts that we've had have been so far away from the altar that they're no longer holy anymore. But Father, if we can just get them back to the altar and drag them back over there and just let it touch the altar, they can be holy once again. And I think of the story of the woman with the issue of blood and reaching out to Jesus. It's that picture that I see of just pushing through all the stuff and all the junk and getting around, finding a way through, and pushing through, just so that I can just touch the hem. That altar of holiness is inside of us, and it has been dedicated and set apart and is holy. And anything that touches it will be made holy. I'm asking you now to search inside and find out what needs to be brought back to the altar. What gifts and talents have been so far removed from the presence of God that we're now using them in our own strength instead of His. And we need to bring them back. We need to fight through the crowd and fight through our mind that's telling us that makes no sense. There's no way we should do that. Whatever. And find that place where we can begin to holy. Get it holy. Get everything gone and bring it to the altar. Father, right now we just cry out for holiness. If you would, saints, just cry out for holiness right now. If you would, it has to come from your mouth. You're the one that has to say it. You're the one that has to ask for it. You're the one that has to desire. If anything that I've said today in any way or has ignited the Holy Spirit inside of you to begin the process of holiness, gifts and talents that you've laid aside that you're no longer necessarily using under the strength of the Holy Spirit, things that have just been so far removed from His presence that it's no longer holy, we just need to bring those gifts and talents back to Him right now and just let it touch the altar so that it can be made holy again. And then those places in our lives that we find that we're just not ready to give up yet, that unforgiveness, the things that we just don't want anybody to know about, and the things that we realize now are weighing us down and costing us twice as much as they used to and keeping us from the fullness and wholeness of God in our lives. Find them. Bring them to the altar. Father, we desire holiness. We desire holiness for holiness' sake. We want to be holy like you are holy. We want to fulfill your desire for your people, which is holiness. Take that a step further and you want to come down here in this area and pray and just really make that, and this has meant something to you, you can do so at this time. I just want to make sure that we have that in our life, that we understand the process of holiness. It doesn't always have to be this serious. It doesn't always have to be this solid, but there are things in our lives that we need to get right today. There are things that God is going to require from us today. There's things that He needs from us this week that is going to require that level of holiness that we have not yet attained. That certainly some things in our life we've allowed to touch to the altar and we've given over to God, but not everything. Have we done that too yet? And there's something being required from us today, tomorrow, in the next few weeks, this year, that is going to require that level of holiness that we've not ever had in our lives before. And He's moving us into the place and giving us an opportunity now to get it right, because then it'll be a lot more difficult. And the situation, it's hard to deal with the situation and worry about making everything holy again. Those things that you haven't let go in your life, the judgments that we have, the unforgiveness that's setting there, the love that we haven't released out into the earth that God has called us to, people that we haven't loved that we should be loving. We've got to drag it to the altar and make it holy. Addictions that keep us bound and keep us from the presence and power of God, we've got to bring it to the altar. It's not worth it anymore. It's not worth it. It was, and we could maintain. But this next level and this next season that God is requiring out of us is requiring something greater and something more. And what was will no longer work. He is requiring holiness out of us. He is moving into us into a place so that we can be identified as His people through holiness. Would you be holy? Would you be that one? Say, Father, I want to be holy as You are holy. The rest of you, you can stand to your feet if you'd like. Hallelujah. As we get ready to dismiss, I just encourage you, I know that God is moving us into a place to set us apart as His own. And I hope that today you've done it, if not today, that sometime this week, somehow, you will get the revelation of the Holy Spirit inside of you. Will move inside and call you to holiness. God is moving us into a place and into a season that is we're going to require a level of holiness that we haven't had before. And I pray that you obey and seize that opportunity when it presents itself. Amen. God bless you guys. Go out and change somebody's life this week. Love you. Have a great week. God bless you.